For Diabetes Awareness Week, we are interviewing Ms. Angie Gorn. And so thank you for joining the CAMP Department, Angie, with for Diabetes Awareness Week.
Thank you.
So I'm gonna ask you a couple questions to tell us more about your role here in Nome and in our region and why diabetes awareness is so important. So can you start off by telling us a little bit about your role and your history with Norton Sound Health Corporation?
Sure. Well, this week I celebrated 23 years of working for Norton Sound. So my entire professional career has been here with Norton Sound Health Corporation. The first 8 years of my career, I spent working with the diabetes program, the CAMP department, and also nutrition services. And the last 16 years, I've been in hospital administration, and the past 8 years, I've been at the CEO level.
Awesome. So your roots are really diabetes here at Norton Sound.
That is what brought me to Norton Sound. I had a lot of fun in those 8 years developing, you know, some programs and creating the CAMP department in 2000 with an amazing team of people. You know, CAMP stands for Chronic Care, Active Management, and Prevention. So we definitely wanted to give diabetes and diabetes prevention a name that really meant something positive to people. Just about everybody goes to CAMP here, and everybody knows when you go to CAMP, you're super active, whether you're hauling wood or picking berries, fishing, hunting, and most likely eating healthy because there aren't a lot of stores around. So you're going to live off the land. And so it was a fun name that we chose. And I'm happy to see that the CAMP department is still known as CAMP today.
Yeah, people always ask me how we got our name. And so actually, I didn't really know the full story. So thank you for sharing that. I had a hunch, but you know, I didn't have my sources confirmed. So that's great. Can you talk a little bit about how your work has contributed to the health promotion and prevention of diabetes?
Well, looking back, you know, in 2000, a lot of funding was made available, not only to Norton Sound Health Corporation as a tribal health organization, but to a lot of tribal health organizations nationwide. And so we were just blessed to have this startup money to develop programs, not only to better manage a certain population of patients who were known diabetics, but to really focus on the prevention of diabetes. And that's where a lot of the programs, I think, that are still in place today, not just in Nome, but also in the villages, you know, we're able to grow from. So Summer Size, I know that started in 2000, and that's still in place today, and it's changed over time, which is great. And it's evolved and has been decentralized. So it's not just in Nome. We try to offer it in the villages every now and then. The step-by-step program is still in existence. Health fairs, I know we don't just focus on a community health fair in Nome, but we still try to decentralize that and take it to the villages as well. And it's grown, so it isn't just screening for blood sugar and blood pressure and you know, cholesterol. Other departments participate and contribute, so it's really a pretty wide health education type community event.
One of my favorite memories as a part of the CAMP department is doing a one woman health fair in Little Diamine. Oh. I did WIC and I did diabetes prevention and I did Healthy Start at the time. So yeah,
good for you.
All of our programs are really dear to me. So why do you think that it's important to create awareness around diabetes?
Well, first of all, you know, diabetes can be prevented. So that's the key message here. And it can be prevented with lifestyle changes. And the people need to be empowered to practice self-care and take ownership so they can make really good decisions. health education makes a huge difference. And we've definitely seen that in our region where this Western diet merges with the traditional diet, native foods. And we just want to keep people aware, our community members, that traditional foods are best. A subsistence lifestyle is super healthy, so that our community will continue to practice that, but to also, once they have that knowledge, they'll pass it on to their children as well.
Definitely. I like that you mentioned self-care. I think a lot of patients are usually surprised when I say to them, you know, there's 42 different things that bring up blood sugar. So it's not just what you're eating or how you're moving. It's so many other things. And so practicing self-care and reducing stress, especially in a year like 2020, is so important. And so I'm glad that you mentioned that. And I mentioned too in my counseling with patients that the subsistence foods are the most perfect food for our bodies here in this region, but actually the act of obtaining those subsistence foods is physical activity, and I don't think you notice it as much when you're actually engaging in that subsistence lifestyle versus, you know, like going to like do an exercise program or something. So you're kind of killing two birds with one stone when you're engaging in that lifestyle.
It's so true. I mean, look at how long it takes to pick just a cup of berries, or I mean, a gallon of berries. That is hard work. And look at the parts of your body that you're using when you do that. You know, your core. I know every time I get back from berry picking, I'm sore. I can feel it, and I want to do it again and again because it felt really good.
Yeah. I've been, you know, every year for like 7 years, I do berry picking, and every year I'm still shocked that my hamstrings are so sore. Like, we all come into work and we're like, oh gosh. So yeah, it's pretty remarkable. So as a professional, you know, we talked a little bit about preventing diabetes and why awareness is important, but can you explain why treating diabetes is also important?
Yes. So diabetes can be treated, it can be managed, so that's a good thing. But when I used to educate patients and I brought my syrup bottle, I would always try to demonstrate, you know, with something that had a lot of sugar in it, so I don't know if you can see this or not.
Yep.
But I would try to explain or just have that patient imagine blood that had a lot of sugar in it versus blood that did not. So just imagine here this syrup bottle. It's, you know, when you tip it, it moves a little bit slower. It's syrupy, right? And so when your blood has that sugar in it, what's got to work harder? Your heart has to pump so much harder. And it's pumping blood through tiny little capillaries that are in our eyes, in our legs, in our kidneys. And, you know, just over time having to work that much harder, and as the blood moves slower, you know, it gives it more time when it's sticky like that to attach to cells and obviously to make them sticky. So you know, you're ultimately keeping that blood sugar as low as you possibly can, so that other parts of your body aren't having to work as hard to get rid of all those sugars. And you know, that's why we recommend blood, and ultimately going to help with formation of clots and prevent other things like strokes, heart disease, or other major complications that come from diabetes. So it really just starts with keeping your sugars, your blood sugar within normal limits, and then managing your diabetes.
Definitely. I always like to put that power back into the patient and say, this is the one disease that, yes, it's a progressive disease, but you can slow that progression and you have control of that. And I think that that's a pretty cool thing about diabetes, is that we know how to treat it and manage it so that you don't have all the complications that can come with that thick, sticky blood. So the prevalence of diabetes continues to increase globally and nationally, with disparities among the American Indian and Alaskan Native population. Can you explain why this is a public health concern?
Yes, well, It definitely is a nationwide epidemic of our own doing. So we know, there are two types of diabetes. Type one, we aren't really sure what all the causes are. That one is more outside of our control, but with type two diabetes, we can prevent it. And as we discussed earlier, it's not just that high blood sugar, it's what are the complications that result from it. So just think about all of the other negative health outcomes that come from diabetes. So there's a pretty long list. Heart disease, depression, dialysis. You know, now you have to have your kidneys filtered by a machine. Amputations, whether it's a foot amputation or a leg amputation. Strokes, you know, it's a pretty long list. And so just the burden on the healthcare system alone, very expensive nationwide, with something that ultimately is within our control to prevent. But I do want to say, even though there's this long list of complications, our region has been extremely fortunate. It's been this way for a very long time. Because the native diet is so good, traditional foods are so healthy, we typically see lower hemoglobin A1Cs in our population. And we have been very successful with reducing, you know, they're called tertiary complications, and that would be the amputation and the dialysis. We have an extremely low rate of those outcomes.
Yeah, it is kind of a positive ending, you know, to this interview even about our region. And you know, I lived in Nome for a number of years, and then I went to finish up my credentials on the Navajo Reservation in Arizona. And I did feel so fortunate for our people here that they do have such a connection to their subsistence lifestyle and how it is so protective for them. So I'm really grateful for that and learning from my patients even more about the subsistence lifestyle and how it can benefit their health. So I think we're all really grateful for that.
I know years ago when we were looking at, you know, what does a new hospital look like at Nurent Sound? And some comments around the table included, you know, where would we put the dialysis unit someday if we needed one? And I'm just really grateful. I think our region's blessed that 20 years later, we still don't need a dialysis unit. It doesn't mean there hasn't been, you know, one or two folks over the past decade that have needed that type of service, but it hasn't been a very large number, so just very fortunate.
I agree. Well, thank you so much for interviewing with me today. It's really fun for me, as you know, in the CAMP department as a new dietitian only within the last couple years, knowing that this is what you were doing back in the day. So glad to have you, and looking forward to all this week's activities to promote awareness around diabetes.
Thank you. And I love all the great work you do. So I'm your biggest fan.
Thanks, Angie.
Thank you.